It's always, well, merong 2002 and 2009 na very small deficits. For most years, the government is actually in surplus. The only reason for the deficit are interest payments and the debt. No? So you are operating, in other words, the government is operating under a very tight budget constraint because it does not want to go into into deficit as far as the blue line is concerned. Why? Because it's scared of public borrowing. This one shows you the total public debt. Well, supposedly, kung meron kang deficit, you borrow, no? And that borrowing adds to the public debt. But here, the trend shows that from 2004 to 2011, you actually have improving debt ratios. The public debt stock has been declining from 2004 to 2011. And a large part of this is because we don't need to borrow from abroad. There's no more need for the Philippines to be borrowing from abroad. And we have been reducing our foreign borrowings, which is a positive development. And therefore, the mix has been, yung red line is the domestic debt and the green bars are the foreign debt. This is just to give you a picture. We will go into more analysis later in the paper.
So in the context of this fiscal situation, let's look at how human rights has been developing. What is the situation of human rights? We want to stress, we're not saying that there's a cause and effect here. We're not saying because of the fiscal crisis, therefore. We're saying there is a relationship, they impact, they affect each other. So what we did was, basically our findings are that human rights remain largely unrealized. Now, we recognize that there are no official statistics available, unlike with the fiscal side, no, with the public finance side. What we did was we looked at the UN treaty bodies' concluding observations after they reviewed the Philippine performance. We looked at the reports of UN special rapporteurs, and we also looked at the MDG indicators. Please note, MDG indicators, only those that are related to rights. Also note that MDG indicators are really what one of the rapporteurs calls imperfect substitutes for measuring a particular right. And nonetheless, it is the only statistics available that we can use. What we looked at are all of these rights, no, as well as the rights of women, children, ITs, migrant persons, and the right to development. Ito, papasadahan ko lang kasi siguro familiar naman kayo sa human rights situation. Tapat. Sa Philippines, no? Ito lang, siguro sa right to life, although widespread, meron pa rin cases ng EJKs at saka EDs, mas bumaba siya dito sa under the Aquino administration. But the point is, it's still there. Okay? We also look at the issue of child soldiers, child mortality, no? Now, eto sa torture, it's still persistent and widespread. At the same time, there's the issue of corporal punishment within the family and even in schools. Pagdating sa right to adequate standard of living, what we're looking here is at poverty. Now, I want to stress one point. When you look at the MDG indicators, the government has this, it loves to change its formula for computing poverty. So, from the time we signed the MDG, throughout our four progress reports until 2010, the Philippines was using one formula. So we could actually track ano ba talaga yung progress natin. Pero pagdating ng 2011, sa ilalim ng bagong administrasyon, tsaka 2012, binago bigla. Pati yung baseline binago. Kaya hindi mo maintindihan ngayon, paano mo ngayon itatrack? No? I mean, if we want to look at how we really work, no? You cannot compare apples with oranges. Eh? You cannot compare situation unless you use exactly the same formula. Since we've changed the formula, it's also difficult. Okay? Education, so ito, lahat ng education, yung deterioration natin, yung increased dropouts, poor schooling facilities, confirmed siya ng MDG indicators. Pagdating sa adequate food, ganun din, binago na naman yung formula dito for hunger. The only thing I want to stress here is that studies show that there are 2 million more hungry Filipinos today than there were when we first signed the MDG. So even if the MDG indicators are showing a decline in hunger in the those who live below the subsistence threshold, the reality is that hunger is actually spreading. Sa health, ito yung isang malaking issue, yung HIV, no? When we first signed the MDGs, talagang halos we were practically doing well. But now there's an increase, a rise in the cases of HIV and AIDS. There's also a lack of awareness about HIV and AIDS. TB is still one of the leading causes, and these are borne out by the MDG indicators. Pagdating ng adequate housing, ito yung malaki talagang problema natin. Maraming porsyento ng ating mga kababayan ay naninirahan sa informal settlement o kaya sa mga high-risk areas. Tsaka marami rin tayo mga street children nationwide. Meron ding large-scale forced evictions. Tsaka kulang ang budgetary allocations for housing. Water and sanitation, here we seem to be doing well. There's already an increase in the number of households with access to water and sanitation. However, even the DILG WASU, the Water Sector Sanitation Program, reports there are 455 barangays still without water, what they're calling waterless municipalities. No? Okay. Pagdating sa right to work, mataas pa rin ang high unemployment and underemployment. Meron pa rin tayong child labor, mababa pa rin yung ating mga minimum wages. Confirmed din ito ng MDG indicators. Pagdating sa rights to women, siguro sino bang women's center dito, women's ombudsman? Yes, yeah, so I think you would be able to confirm this. This is also the information from the UN. No? Okay. And then, rights of the child, sinong CRC dito, Child Rights Center. By the way, one of the recommendations is to increase your budget by the UN. No? It's one of the recommendations. So, ito yung mga issues relating to children. Sa IPs, ito pa rin yung mga issues. Although malaki dito, ang focus dito talaga would be the impact of extractive activities or industries such as mining on IPs and on their land. No? And then rights of migrant persons. So ito meron pa silang ano. May issue dito tinatawag ng feminization of migration. Ito yung that many of our women are entering into industries associated with women, including the care industry, including the what they call entertainment industry, etc. Then you have, when it comes to the right to development and ESCR, you have widespread corruption, you have debt service payments. So in other words, a large part of our budget is going to service our debt. At the same time, we are decreasing our spending on social services, on health, education, etc. Okay. Now, based on those are the realities when it comes to public finance and human rights in the Philippines. So what we did was we developed now what is the approach, the human rights-based approach to public finance. So again, it is founded on the Philippine framework, which you are all familiar with. Essentially, if you look at this, the definition of what is HRPA to public finance, no? So it is a framework based on human rights norms, standards, and principles that guarantees the mobilization and maximum use of the country's available resources to progressively realize human rights for all, especially those most vulnerable, under a regime of shared control over the country's financial resources. So we're going to break this down. No? This, you can notice there are four elements: primacy of the human person, support for the realization of human rights, maximum available resources, and shared control over the country's financial resources. Before we break it down, I want to stress who the actors are. No? So you have, as usual, our claim holders. So, nandito na siya nakalista. In the middle, you have our duty bearers. Ang CHR kasama dito bilang duty bearer, bilang public accountability institution. And then we have other actors, kasama na dito lahat ng klase ng business, pati yung mga MNCs, so multinational corporations, lahat ng mga NGOs, citizens groups, etc. One of the ways I want to discuss what is the difference between HRBA to public finance and the standard view of public finance is to compare the two. The standard view, or the typical view towards public finance, places a primary focus on finance capital. Samantalang HRBA, ang primary focus ng HRBA ay ang tao. Pangalawa, ang standard view ng public finance, what they look at would be economic growth factors tsaka macroeconomic economic variables. Tapos sa kanila, ang economic growth is an end in itself. Samantalang sa HRBA, ang tinitingnan natin economic growth as a means towards human development. At ang pinopromote natin ay ang equal enjoyment ng karapatan ng kababaihan at kalalakihan ng walang diskriminasyon. The standard view of public finance looks at the role of the state as in creating conditions for the functioning of free market and maintaining macroeconomic stability and debt sustainability. Samantalang sa HRBA, pinofocus talaga natin ang obligation to mobilize the maximum of available resources at saka gamitin ito to progressively realize human rights for all. Importante rin sa atin yung avoidance of retrogressive measures at yung mga obligasyon to respect, protect, and fulfill human rights. The standard view of public finance looks at the private sector bilang source of financial resources. Kaya meron tayong PPP o public-private partnership. Samantalang sa HRBA, ang tinitingnan nating papel ng private sector ay to respect, protect, at saka i-remit ang mga human rights. Pagdating naman sa standard view, not ang sa issue ng sino ba talagang nagko-control ng public finance, sa standard view, public finance is generally seen as a very close space limited sa mga finance managers ng Pilipinas. Samantalang sa HRBA, ang pinapush talaga natin ay shared control, meaning to say greater participation, accountability, transparency, empowerment, at saka rule of law. So tulad ng nabanggit ko kanina, apat ang elements ng HRBA framework. So primacy of the human person, etc. No? Iisa-isahin natin yan. Yung primacy of the human person talaga, ang napaka-importante dito, tinitingnan natin ang tao bilang pinaka-sentro ng public finance. At sinasabi natin, ang kondisyon ng tao ang dapat maging patayan ng lahat ng aksyon at desisyon ng public finance. So all fiscal decisions should be geared towards improving the quality of life. At dapat meron tayong special attention to those most vulnerable. Pag sinasabi naman nating support for the realization of human rights, ang sinasabi natin, public finance should do things so that both women and men will equally enjoy their rights. And very clear kasi yung issue ng non-discrimination. Ang problema kasi pagdating sa public finance, ang discrimination in public finance is very subtle. Hindi siya yung lantaran, hindi yung madaling makita. So meron chances like ng mga examples ng discrimination. Halimbawa, when we invest, like we do, no, we have a lot of public investment in private water, MWSS water supply, okay, for urban area. At the same time, we're not having as much public investment in the water supply in the provinces. So that a lot of the water supply in the provinces would be LGU run o kaya level 2. Yun yung mga balon, yun yung mga deep well, no? So there is a disproportionate spending. You're spending on piped water mostly for major cities, but for urban area, for rural areas, you're going to spend only on level 1 and level 2 type of water. So that is a form of discrimination. Another form is that when you have a tax system where the burden of paying the taxes is heavier on those who are living in poverty, that is again discrimination. Now, when we talk about support for the realization of human rights, we're also looking at the normative content of the right. So in other words, what you're spending for should be on the normative content of the right you want to realize. And this, the laman ng normative content, familiar na kayo dyan, alam niyo na yan, hindi ko napapasadaan. Now, yung third leg ng framework, yung konsepto ng maximum available resources. Sa totoo lang, institutionally, pati sa human rights field, hindi talaga nila dinidefine ano ba talaga ang ibig sabihin ng maximum available resources. Pero ang sinasabi nila, hindi siya pwedeng limitado sa budget. So, ang take-off namin is from that perspective. Hindi lang budget ang nagde-determine kung ano ang maximum available resources ng isang bansa. Ang framework namin says that when you talk about maximum available resources, you're talking about all the resources available in the economy of a particular country. So that will include human resources, that will include natural resources, financial resources, etc., etc. So what we're saying, when we use the term full employment, and you will be hearing that, no? Repeatedly, especially when we discuss Clarence's section, we're not referring to employment as in work. What we're talking is you are mobilizing, you're making maximum use of the full productive capacity of our economy. So that's what we mean when we say full employment. Now, you can also look at maximum available resources, or MAR, no? From the concept of what is known as fiscal space. Para siyang ito mas alam ni Clarence ito, pero para siyang diamond na merong apat na points, no? Ang bawat point niya represents a particular policy option. Okay? So you have expanded, ito yung policy options niya. Now, what this group of researchers in the US, Balakrishnan, did was, instead of a 4-point diamond, they made it a 5-point star. So they added monetary and central bank policy. Generally, when you look at fiscal space, what you're looking at is expenditure. Ano yung priorities ng expenditure at saka kaano ka-efficient ang expenses nyo. Pangalawa, paano kayo nag-mobilize ng resources sa taxation o sa ibang paraan. Pangatlo, ano yung mga aid na dumadating galing sa ibang bansa. Pang-apat, ito yung deficit financing, either through borrowing, no? Borrowing essentially, o kaya printing money. So ito yung deficit financing. Tapos ang ginawa nga nila Balakrishnan, inat nila yung monetary and central bank policy. From a human rights perspective, when you look at maximum available resources, you are actually stressing two obligations. Familiar tayo sa obligation of progressive realization, di ba? Obligation to make maximum use of available resources. Ang interpretation namin, binrake up namin sa dalawa. First, you have an obligation to mobilize. And then, you have an obligation to use. So, hiniwalay namin yon. So, yung obligation to mobilize, eto yon. Sa totoo lang, wala namang threshold or target na sinasabi, each country should mobilize X million, billion dollars, whatever. Walang ganun. Ang mangyayari, the Philippines should set its own threshold of how much money it needs to mobilize. And generally, you mobilize through taxation, foreign aid, debt, deficit financing, etc., etc. When you say obligation to make maximum use of what you have mobilized, then we should give priority to those items that meet human rights treaty obligation and that support the realization of human rights. Very important when you're using both obligations is that we avoid retrogressive measures. So last time I was here, we discussed the principle of non-retrogression. I will not repeat what the principle of non-retrogression is because I already discussed it last August. May example lang ako dito, no? Remember, you this in when you're a retrogressive measure, you have to have a direct cause and effect. So if, for example, you reduce spending on maternal health care, and that reduction leads to an increase in maternal mortality, then that is a violation of the principle of non-retrogression and also a violation of human rights. Okay. Again, we talked about when can human rights be prioritized. When I was here last August, I will not discuss because that is linked, no? Principle of non-retrogression linked with prioritization. Now, for obligations, we discussed this also last time I was here. What I wanted to do and what is on the slide would be, ano, when we say, ano ba talagang minimum content ng bawat karapatan? Diba? Yun yung laging tanong eh. What is the minimum core content or the minimum essential level of a right? Because the core obligation is non-derogable. Ibig sabihin, you have to comply with it. So, eto siya, no? So, nakalista na siya dyan. Ang sinasabi dito, our framework says that when we spend, we should, and when we raise money, we should make sure that we are satisfying the minimum essential levels of all human rights. Okay? Now, eto, then of course, maximum available resources, kasama din sa obligations to mobilize and obligations to make maximum use, would be of course the obligations to respect, protect, and fulfill. So eto na yung mga examples dyan. And obvious na yun yung obligation to fulfill, provide dahil sa nangyari sa Typhoon Pablo. So yun, obvious na ngayon. Okay. Kasama rin sa maximum available resources, ang papel at responsibilities ng private sector. And particularly important dahil sa PPP, and PPP seems to be a major thrust of the Philippine government. Ang sa PPP kasi, doon kung familiar kayo sa public-private partnership, dito nagbibigay ng incentive ng government sa mga private corporation. Tapos meron silang ginagarantee, tsaka pinaprotektahan din nila yung mga private companies. So there's a lot of, in other words, private companies who are engaging in PPP projects really get a lot of support and a lot of incentives from the Philippine government. And these incentives actually are related to the taxes that we pay or to, and to what we actually are able to spend on. So what I've done here is to consolidate the RUGI framework together with the guiding principles on business and human rights adopted by the UN. So eto na yung examples ng respect, protect, remedy framework. The last leg of the framework is the shared control over available resources. And here we're stressing the principles of participation, accountability, transparency, empowerment, and rule of law. Napansin ninyo, wala dyan yung non-discrimination kasi nandun na siya sa support for the realization of human rights. Wala yung human dignity. Yung sa Panther, wala dito yung human dignity kasi nandun na yun sa focus on the human person. So, kaya ito yung pinofocus na principles dito sa shared control. Now, given this particular theoretical framework, how do you then apply it to the public finance cycle? The public finance cycle is a different colored circle. So it's fiscal policy, public revenues, public expenditure, public borrowing, tsaka public accountability. Ito yung cycle, public finance cycle siya. Ngayon, ang mga boxes corresponding, same color boxes, doon nakasulat ang mga human rights principles that are applicable to each cycle. Nagbabago kasi siya eh. Hindi siya yung, although may generic, kaya medyo actually in-explaining ko rin ito kina Boyin on, kina EDJ, Trafe Karen. This is one of the harder frameworks that we have developed because we needed to create a master framework and then we needed to bring it down to the level of application in the different areas. So iba-ibang human rights principles and norms ang nag-a-apply sa iba't ibang aspeto ng public finance cycle. So dito, and that's you. Now I go into how do we apply. Okay. First, we will look at public budget. No. When you look, basically, what we're doing is answering three questions here. What do we mean when we say human rights-based public budget? Ano ba siya? Pangalawa, ano ba yung mga innovations ngayon ng PBM at coherent ba ito sa karapatang pantao? Pangatlo, paano ba natin, how do we do this? How do we do human rights-based budget work at saka budget analysis? So, ang tingin namin, ang budget kasi talaga isang napakahalagang dokumento, kaya policy instrument para ma-realize ang rights natin. Sa totoo lang, walang magawa ang gobyerno kung hindi nakasulat sa budget. Hindi kayo pwedeng kumilos pag wala sa budget. Kaya napaka-importante yan kung talagang ang papel natin is we really want to realize right, we really then need the budget. Now, if we look at the 1987 Constitution, ito yung mga norms at saka standards na pinupush ng 1987 Constitution. Kaya kailangan ang budget natin ay geared towards equity, social justice, and full respect for human rights. Tapos, titingnan din natin ano pa talaga ang required sa mga treaties na niratify natin. And at the same time, ano pa yung mga, and based on that, we will see all the treaty obligations that require, that is requiring, that requires, sorry, treaty obligations required to be fulfilled by the public budget. Then there are also a series of PBM memoranda where they stress the principles of participation, accountability, transparency, equality, and attention to most vulnerable. I will stress, however, that when the PBM uses these principles, it does not define them or apply them from the context of human rights, but from its own interpretation of what this means. And I will explain this a little later on. Okay. A very important norm is that the budget should not violate human rights. Okay. So what I have done here is I've made it's more written in the paper, but here are examples of what would be human rights violations directly attributable to our national budget. So kasama na dito is pagka meron tayong discrimination, pag meron tayong reduction or diversion of a particular item that results in non-enjoyment of human rights, o kaya kulang ang binibigay natin na pondo, kaya hindi may enjoy yung karapatang pantao, that is also a violation of human rights. Ngayon, tingnan naman natin, ito yung, you know, at least hanggang 2016, dahil sa panibagong administrasyon, meron silang tinatawag na social contract, alam na alam siguro ninyo yun. Kaya meron silang 5KRA, key result area. So, ang linaw doon sa lahat ng PBM memoranda, lahat ng budget will always be oriented towards the social contract. Lately, there have been five main innovations to the budget process. Ito yung zero-based budgeting, citizen participation, yung tinatawag na BUPP or bottom-up planning, program approach, at saka gender mainstreaming. Ang i-discuss ko lang, ang ipinokus lang namin, yung citizen participation, bottom-up planning, tsaka gender mainstreaming. Okay? So, dito, meron kasi silang bagong circular tungkol sa citizen participation. You know, okay naman sana, maganda naman sana kasi binubuksan nila. Ito yung kaya ako sinasabing hindi siya talaga rights-based ang approach nila. Kasi, tingin nila, una, only those CSOs that are registered with government can actually participate. So, paano yung mga social movements na hindi siya registered sa SEC? Hindi na pwede. Okay? Kasi kailangan, so, kulang na yun. Okay. Pangalawa, kailangan subject to quote-unquote proper screening na gagawin ng NGA or National Government Agency o kaya GOCC. So, siyempre, pag ma-screen ka, kung ikaw di ka type ng ahensya dahil patikos ka ng patikos ng ahensya, pwede kang ma-screen out. So there is a risk of exclusion because sino ba talaga magde-decision kung sino ang pwede mag-participate o hindi? Yung ahensya. Okay. Pangalawa, kailangan meron tinatawag na principles of engagement na binuo daw ng DBM at saka ilang mga CFO. Hindi lahat. Ngayon, kung ikaw, whether or not you agree with that, you are required to abide by those particular principles. So, ito pa, ang entitlement mo, kapag meron kang budget, anong budget partnership agreement, kasi mag-enter ka into a BPA. Pag meron kang budget partnership agreement, bibigyan ka ng impormasyon ng agency. At saka imbitahin ka sa at least one consultation meeting. Okay? Tapos, pwede kang mag-monitor, pwede kang mag-ano, pero ano pa man ang sabihin mo, in the end, ang mangyayari, lahat ng recommendations ninyo, lahat ng findings ninyo, will be used only as input. So, obviously, hindi siya participation from the human rights perspective. This marks of consultation. I will just ask you what you think. In the end, I will do what I want to do, which is not participation. Remember, for us, participation is both a right and a principle. So I have some concerns about the citizen participation envisioned by the DPM. Pangalawa, yung bottom-up planning and budgeting. Ito, piloted ito in several hundred or thousands of municipalities in 2012. I understand that right now, they're already inputting some of the projects for the 2013. It was already included in the 2013, and they will now, they're consolidating it now for the 2014. They're consolidating now for 2014. Okay na rin sana yung concept-wise maganda eh. Yung concept na, let us get our community residents, our barangay residents to begin planning. Maganda yung konsepto. Pero pagdating sa actual implementation, eto na naman tayo. Kasi eto, sinasabi nila, meron silang LPRAP, yung Local Poverty Reduction Action Plan Workshop. Okay? Sa mangyayari dito, si LGU, kung si Mayor man siya o kung sino man yan, siya ang gagawa ng lahat ng situation analysis patay sa mga information or statistics available sa kanya. Katapos, during the workshop, sasabihin niya, community, eto sitwasyon ninyo. Okay, validate niyo naman, sige sabihin niyo kung tama o hindi. Sa akin naman, hindi, eto na naman tayo, hindi naman yan participation. Sino ba talaga nakakaranas ng sitwasyon nila? Sino ba talaga alam kung ano ba talaga ang mga karapatan nila that need good feeling. Diba yung tao? So, dapat sila mismo ang magsagawa ng sariling situational analysis. Hindi dapat na ibibigay na lang sa kanila. Tapos, eto, lahat ng projects, kasi ang mangyayari, meron kasi tinatawag na menu of programs. Eto yung iba't ibang mga programa ng select government agencies. So, meron silang listahan. Kung ikaw yung community, pipili ka lang kung anong nandun. So, hindi rin naman siya totally, truly bottom-up planning. Kasi pataw pa rin eh, pipili ka lang. As compared to what is actually happening, for example, in Porto Alegre in Brazil. In Brazil, they actually really decide how much money magkano ang na-collecta natin? How much have we collected? Okay, we collected 100 pesos. As a community, let us decide how much are we giving to education, how much are we giving to health. So it's the actual community that decides that. This is very, very different from the bottom-up planning. In the end, ang final decision, no? Kasi basically what's going to happen is lahat ng mga projects that the community chooses isa-submit pa rin sa DBM. In the end, DBM pa rin ang mag-decision ng agency tsaka yung DBM kung alin dyan ang pupondohan. So, in effect, hindi mo pa rin kontrolado. Hindi pa rin kontrolado ng tao yung buong proseso. Yes, ma'am. Andun nga sa paper namin eh, it's already the analysis, the human rights perspective, analyzing the DBM innovations is part of the paper. which we have actually requested. I asked CHR to ask DBM, DOF, and other agencies, as well as some NGOs, to critique, to peer review this document. But yes, the analysis is there. Okay. The third innovation is gender mainstreaming, and this I really like and I welcome, and I think it's an excellent DBM memo. Finally, I mean, it's a really, really long delay. Ito kasi, maganda kasi, una, ginawa ito ng PCW together with DBM, NEDA, etc. Ang ginawa nila talaga, for the first time, expressly, nakalink siya sa CEDAW, nandun sa Beijing platform, sa MGD, MDGs. Yun. Tapos, nire-require talaga nila yung gender mainstreaming sa lahat ng PAPs. Tsaka nire-require nila yung gender audit. What I appreciated about it was that first they said, all gender, all God projects, no, or the God money can be spent two ways. Either client focus, meaning to say may mga programs or projects kayo that are for the outside, o kaya internal. So if you have gender issues that you wish to address within your agency, you can now use the God money for that, no, the God, the 5%. At the same time, they're saying this is what these are on the slide are the suggested God spending, which is better than spending it on how to make polvoron or some stupid thing, which is what some agencies have been doing. This is very, very welcome. It will only take effect beginning 2013. Okay. So this section ends with HRBA and public budget on how examples of how HR-based budget work and budget analysis is being done. There's a difference between budget work and budget analysis according to FAO. Sabi ng FAO, ang budget analysis simpleng limitado sa analysis ng mga nakalista sa budget, yung figures. Pero pag gumawa ka ng budget work, dito kasama na dito yung monitoring, kasama na dito yung monitoring ng spending, kasama na dito yung policy work, yung lobbying, etc., etc. So, mas malawak yung konsepto ng budget work kumpara sa budget analysis. So what we have on the slide and what has been described in the paper would be the different ways by which budget work and budget analysis is being undertaken by different groups all over the world. I'll not bother to describe them now. Now, from the big picture of the budget, puntahan naman natin ang revenue. Ang focus, no? Ang pagdating sa revenues, okay, o magkano ang nakakolekta natin, ang focus ng paper has three questions. Bakit ba tayo kailangan magbayad ng tax? Why should one pay tax? Pangalawa, ano ba yung Philippine tax performance? Have we really mobilized the maximum of available financial resources? Pangatlo, what kinds of taxes should we have that will support the realization of human rights without discrimination? So, paying taxes is a basic duty of everybody under Article 29 of the UDHR. At the same time, we have to look at taxation in two ways. It provides public goods. You know, the money that we give provides public goods and services. At the same time, it can also redistribute wealth. How? When we have, for example, our social protection, our social security benefits, death benefits, etc., is actually redistributing wealth. But we have to also remember that when we look at taxation, and I am focusing on taxation, I will explain why a little later on. When you're looking at taxation, it has to be limited by human rights principles. And what are the specific principles that apply to taxation? Una yung proportionality. Ibig sabihin, anuman ang taxes na binabayaran mo ay dapat patay or base sa inyong abilidad o kapasidad na magbayad. So it's based on your economic ability. Pangalawa, yung principle of equity. Ibig sabihin, people who are similarly placed should pay similar taxes. People who are not similarly placed should pay not the same tax. Diba? Magkakaparehas ang earnings natin, we should be paying the same tax. Pag mas malaki yung earnings mo sa earnings ng iba, dapat mas malaking tax yung mas malaking kinikita kaysa mas maliit na kita. Ito yung principle of equity. Tapos, yung principle of non-retroactivity. Ibig sabihin, huwag ka namang magpataw ng tax ngayon na i-apply mo sa kinita ko last year or 20 years ago. Next, yung principle of reasonableness. So, dapat, ang taxation dapat reasonable, hindi siya dapat maging arbitrary. And then, yung huli, dapat respetuhin ng taxation ang due process rights natin, particularly pag may time ng tax assessment or may tax dispute. Okay? Ngayon, after looking at the principles, let's look at how has the Philippines performed. Ano pa talaga, kuya? Have we been, Clarence mentioned this in his first slide, revenues are falling. In fact, we have a very low tax effort, okay? So, it's been going down from 2006 to 2011, and our slide up to 2009, has actually shown that it's going down. Why? We have a significant issue of tax leakages. Ang tax leakage is simply non-compliance. There are two forms of tax leakage. Tax evasion, meaning to say, ayoko magbayad at gagawa ako ng illegal na paraan para hindi ako magbayad. Yun yung tax evasion. Pag sinabi naman natin tax avoidance, ayoko magbayad at gagamit ako ng legal na paraan para hindi magbayad. Okay, so that's the difference between evasion and avoidance. One uses illegal means and the other uses legal means. Okay? So, andun yung mga examples ng tax avoidance. No? Ang estimate ng tax leakages ng Pilipinas, matay sa isang pag-aaral ng Ibon Foundation dated 2009, ay nagpapakita kung gaano kalaki ang nawawala sa atin. So, makikita ninyo, very staggering yung amounts that the Philippines is losing. 127 billion through tax evasion. From 98 to 2002, anong nawawala natin sa VAT? 41.6 billion. Tapos, ito yung importante, and this is also a form of discrimination in taxation. Studies are showing that wage salaried, no, and wage earners, dahil nga withhold yung taxes ninyo, so compliance with taxation is very high. You have no choice, withhold ng employer. Pero pagdating sa businessmen and professionals, underpayment sila eh because they don't state their correct income. So you can see how much we are losing in taxes, in tax revenues from that. When we're talking now, the question here is what is taxation without discrimination? What do we mean by that? Our 1987 Constitution mandates we have a tax system that is uniform and equitable, and that is moving towards progressive taxation. We have two kinds of taxes, direct tax and indirect tax. Pag sinasabing direct tax, ito yung base sa capacity mo. So, ito yung examples niya, yung income tax, capital gains tax, etc. Ang direct tax, hindi mo pwedeng i-shift sa iba. Ano man ang kinita mo, babayad ka directly doon. Kaya dahil direct tax siya, hindi siya nagtetend to increase the prices of other goods and services in the society. In principle, mas equitable ang direct tax. Pero nga, ito yung sinabi kong kanina, sa Pilipinas, kahit direct tax na, pwede ka pa rin mag-discriminate kung yung salary na wini-withhold compared sa mga businessmen and professionals na nag-voluntarily disclose. Okay? Pag sinabi naman natin indirect tax, ito yung VAT, no? Halimbawa yung VAT. Ito yung tax paid by somebody else. Halimbawa, every item we buy, the manufacturer passes the tax to you. You go visit a doctor or you go to a lawyer outside for that service that you are paying, which the lawyer should pay for or the doctor should pay for. The indirect taxation or the VAT allows them to pass the tax to you. So that's why it tends to increase the prices of goods and services because it is shifted from the person to whom it is supposed to be levied onto the buyer or the consumer of the good or the service. So it can also increase inequality. Bakit? I earn a certain amount of money. I compare what I buy, whatever, a ball pen. Somebody who does not earn anything, a person living in poverty, buys a ball pen. Both that person and me pay the same tax, even if our income is different. We're paying the same tax, we're buying the same item. But the reality is, yung tax that I paid is a lower percent of my income compared to yung tax na binayaran ng isang mahirap. Dahil mas malaking porsyento yun sa maliit niyang income. So in that sense, it is discriminatory. Now, based on the program of the BBM for fiscal year 2013, this is the revenue program ng BBM. We are actually, it's almost 1:1. Anong ibig sabihin? Ang projections ng BBM is that we are, for every 1 peso direct tax we're collecting, we're also collecting 1 peso in indirect. Dati kasi, if you're looking at it in the past, the bulk of our revenues was from indirect taxation. Now it's almost 50-50. If you're looking at, 48-49% in 2011. 47-48% in 2012, 48-47% in 2013. No? So the Philippines is still intending to rely a lot on indirect taxation or the VAT. Because it's easy to collect. It lessens the work of the government actually. That's the bottom line. Anyway, continue, no? Okay. I don't know. We have an RA, a Republic Act, which exempts taxes on all minimum wage earners. Okay? Galing, no? Ang problema, kapag halimbawa, may salary increase, kahit sabihin mong piso araw-araw ang increase, kano ba yung 30 pesos a month, no? Taxable na yan. Kasi hindi ka na minimum eh. So magbabayad ka ngayon ng tax. Yung pabayaran mong tax, mas malaki pa sa 30 pesos na dinagdag sa'yo. No? So, in effect, we're talking direct taxation, okay? So, it can still be discriminatory. In effect, you're earning less than you were than when you were earning as a minimum wage earner, right? When you were tax-free. When it comes to indirect, I already discussed is the VAT in relation to a proportion of our income. Now, there's one thing we noticed, no? I've come across studies in other countries which says that a lot of the items that are made for or targeting women actually cost more than the same items targeting men. They found this in the US and in the UK. Halimbawa, shampoo. Ang shampoo ng babae, mas mahal ang gastos kesa sa shampoo ng lalaki. Deodorant. What yung everyday items siguro, no? So, if in those cases, dahil all of these items are vatable or subject to indirect taxation, lumalabas, mas mataas ang VAT na binabayaran ng kababaihan kesa sa kalalakihan. Ang problema ko was this in the Philippines, wala kaming nahanap na Philippine study on taxation and gender. So it's a major gap here. It's a gap that we identified and I think it's something we need to seriously consider. Ano ba talaga ang impact ng taxation on women in the Philippines? Now, ang taxation without discrimination also means promotion of human rights, right? And yung recently passed sin taxes are one way. Sin tax is also called corrective taxation or repricing. That's what they call it. Corrective taxation, repricing. In other words, you're changing the price, no? Or the sin tax. Why? Look, I'm a smoker and all, but I will still support this. Although I might end up cutting down my smoking because I don't know if I can afford it next year. Okay? Which is really the point. Yeah, and I shouldn't, but I still am. Okay, so the point is, If you're making this good so expensive or more expensive, you're actually promoting a right to health. In the same manner, you can promote the right to a healthy environment when we impose tax on oil, tax on carbon emissions, and tax on mining. So those would be corrective taxation. Then, now, we're looking at taxation support satisfying the minimum essential levels of human rights or the core obligations. Diba? Dapat, taxes should not limit access to goods and services and facilities that we need for to meet the minimum essential level of the rights. May problema tayo ng konti dito, although meron tayong tinatawag na exemption sa ilalim ng VAT. Diba? So, ito yung next slide ko. Dito nakasulat kung ano yung VAT exempt. Okay. Halimbawa, take natin yung right to food. Ang sabi natin, ang minimum essential level ng right to food, yung essential food stuff na kailangan natin para kumain. Ano yung exempted? Livestock, fingerling, poultry, other products in their original state. Okay? Seeds, meron pa dito mga, palay, services for palay, corn, etc. In their raw state. Yun lang ang exempt. So, okay lang sana yan. Makain ba kayo ng raw? Will you eat it raw? Of course not. You'll cook it naman, di ba? Pero namin lalagay ka pa ng toyo, pag cheese, whatever. Yung iba, fatable. Fatable, meaning to say subject to fat. So, if we're saying we want to make sure that there is always access to essential foodstuff, we can't have any kind of taxes that will limit our access to that particular essential foodstuff, right? Otherwise, we're not going to be complying with our core obligation. And that's why I'm saying the VAT is problematic. Yes, it gives exemptions, but not everything is VAT exempt. And therefore, if it will impact on our minimum essential levels, then it becomes a human rights matter, an issue. Okay? Now, finally, when we talk about taxation without discrimination, what we're saying is taxation should promote shared control. After all, the truth is, that's our money na money. So why should we leave it to some other people to control our money? We should be the ones to control our money. So what we're asking is greater participation, greater transparency, and the inclusion of accountability mechanisms in taxation. So now we move from taxes to spending. Okay? There are two questions we want to answer here. What should we spend on to realize human rights? Pangalawa, magkano? And how much? And how will we arrive at that amount? Okay. What should we spend on? O kaya what we're calling human rights norms of expenditures. Dapat titingnan natin kung ano nakasulat sa 1987 Constitution at saka sa mga legally binding treaties. So, nandun yun sa mga annexes sa paper. So, nasa slide yung mga examples lamang. Some examples of what we should be spending on. Pag tinignan din natin yung concluding observations, here I'll spend a little more time because I don't think too many people have read the concluding observations. Patay sa UN Committee on ESCR, sabi niya, we should spend more on health, housing, and education, poverty eradication, integration of ESCR in poverty eradication, at saka housing. Sabi naman ng CAT or Committee Against Torture, we need more money to develop and renovate our prisons and detention facilities. We need high priority funding for the witness protection program, and we need funding for the anti-Bausi law. Sabi ng CRC, no? CRC reviewed the Philippine performance twice. The first time in relation to CRC itself, and the second time in relation to the optional protocol on conflict situation. So on the CRC itself, sabi ng CRC committee, we should mainstream NPAC, National Plan of Action for Children. Mainstream NPAC the specific budget lines, provide funds to LGUs to implement NPAC, provide funding to your CRC, your CHRP CRC, apply child rights approach to budgeting, give funding for disadvantaged children. Proposal nila ang budgeting system daw natin should be transparent and participatory, and we should be able to prevent corruption and continuous funding for health. Under the optional protocol, sinabi rin ng committee, dapat may adequate funds for the implementation of the optional protocol. Ito yung sa issue ng child soldiers. And then, dapat daw may funding ang CHR at saka deputy ombudsman para ma-monitor ninyo ng tama at sapat ang compliance with the optional protocol. Sa ilalim naman ng CFCFW, sabi ng committee, we need to devolve funds to yung shared government, yung indicator system ng government, SGISM. Dapat may training and capacity building for agencies developed in migration, at saka dapat i-fund daw natin yung reintegration program. Okay, kung titingnan naman natin ano ba dapat ang gagastusan natin, dapat tingnan natin in relation sa obligations ng state at saka sa normative content ng selected rights. So halimbawa sa education, merong construction ng school building, pero dapat yung school building, pwede pa may banyo naman, may sanitation, may tubig, etc. And then, magkano? Hindi ako pwedeng magsabi sa inyo kung magkano. I cannot give you an amount. I cannot tell you how much. It is something that we as a country should actually sit down and decide as a people. No one. There is no threshold. There's no target. There's nothing domestically or internationally. We need to develop or determine our own level of spending. Now, what I want to share with you is this. People might think, baka magastos yan. Human rights, magastos yan eh, kasi matagal yan, etc. And what I want to share is, no, it's not, it may not be as expensive as you think it is. In 2007, Rosario Manasan of PIDS NEDA, she estimated how much we would need to meet the MDGs related to poverty, education, health, water, and sanitation from 2007 hanggang 2015. She did it using high and low cost estimates and using the PDP and low PDP projections. And you will be shocked at her finding, at yung finding niya. She's, what the first column are her assumptions. The second column is, magkano is available, how much we already have. Pangatlong column, magkanong kailangan natin. Pang-apat na column, anong kulang? And if you look at it, okay, using the high cost PDP growth rate projection, we have already 3.1 trillion pesos. Okay? We need 3.9 trillion pesos. That means kulang na lang sa atin 777.9. Remember, I'm talking 2007 hanggang 2015. That's 8 years. Ha? I mean, I'm not talking 1 year. If you're looking at it as a percent of our GDP, then it's even more shocking kasi what we're saying is we only need 3.88% of our GDP to actually, that's the requirement, no? What we have is 3.12%. That what means we only have to raise less than 1%. And it's not that big. And we're talking all these years, hindi siya ganun kalaki. So long as we sit down and talk about it, okay? When the country decides to set, we have to remember what is stated in our 1987 constitution na dapat education should have the larger share. Ang problema natin dito, yung kaso ni Gingona versus Carague in 1991, kung saan kinwestiyon nila Gingona yung amount, no? Sinasabi kasi ni Gingona, bakit mas malaki, halos 30-35% na ng budget ang pumupunta sa debt service? Samantalang sabi ng konstitusyon, ang pinakamalaking porsyento dapat ng budget ay pumunta sa edukasyon. Ano ang sabi ng Supreme Court dito? Basta basta lumalaki ang binibigay natin sa education, that is constitutional. And importante rin naman kasi dahil sa reputation ng Pilipinas na magbayad tayo ng debt. So, according to Karage, to that particular decision, you can continue paying more and more debt or a higher percentage on debt with, and it is still going to be considered constitutional. Now, a lot of people are talking about WHO recommendation, no? Or WHO level of spending, yung tinatawag na 5% ng WHO. Every country must spend 5% of GDP on health. Yun, madalas. Actually, it turns out, hindi pala siya correct. There's no such thing as a recommendation or target. What happened was, a long time ago, it was used as an indicator or to measure, mainly because that was the amount of spending in the EU countries. But things have changed from the time that 5% came out, and the situation in EU countries and in our countries is not the same. So there is no such recommendation. You can use it if you want as for guidance, but that's about it. We need to set our own level, our own threshold. And my proposal is, because, and I know sabi nila Jake at saka ni Karen sa akin, sukat-sukat na kayo sa office, but I think we need to mainstream HRBA into office. And how do I do this? So I have a proposal already to mainstream HRBA in office. You know, ang OPIF, para siyang lag frame, eh, di ba? May sectoral goal, may sector outcome, organizational outcome. Kayo, ganun yun, no? MFO, at saka PAPS. Ganun yun. So what I've done is, pag sinabi nating sector goal, ilink naman natin sa realization of a specific right. Pag sinabi nating sector outcome, ilink na natin sa normative content ng right na yon. Pag sinabi nating organizational outcome, ilink natin sa obligations ng government. Pag sinabi nating MFO, ito yung mga goods, services, and activities that support the realization of the right. At pag sinabi nating PAP, ito na yung mga activities that integrate the Panther principles and that are needed so that we can achieve an MFO. Yun yung proposal. Now, I have also suggested a 12-step process very close to the process of OPIF. I used their latest manual. But I changed it around. So for example, I think the first step nila is situation analysis is always their first step, di ba? So what we're saying here is first, the NGA, like the CHR, for example, convenes all your claim holders, duty bearers, and your other actors. Then, together with them, you then decide what right or rights are we linked to, and we analyze whether or not that specific right or rights are being realized or enjoyed, and we pay close attention to those most vulnerable. So we're doing situation analysis collectively, rather than agency alone to do that. And then from there, we will then together, still collectively, because this is really genuine participation, we then identify what, because we've identified what is the level of enjoyment, and we're looking at progressive realization, let us identify what is the target level of enjoyment. What level of enjoyment do we want for women and men? And then after that, step four, we will then identify, so that is our societal goal. By step three, we're already setting up our societal goal. On step four, break down natin ang societal goal natin into normative content and determine what is, and this is how we formulate our sector outcomes. And then step five, which is the formulation of organizational outcomes, we're linking the rights that we're promoting directly to specific concrete obligations. And we're formulating these obligations into organizational outcomes. But the things of step six, MFOs and PAP, we will then identify the outputs and activities needed to identify our goals, integrating the Panther principles. But the thing ng step seven, dito na yung performance indicators. Okay? Now, pagdating sa step 8, ang proposal ko, yung NEDA kasi gumawa sila ng right space log frame. Sa OPIF kasi required kayo mag-use ng log frame, di ba? So dito, sa halip ng gamitin yung log frame ng typical, ang proposal ko is gamitin nyo na lang yung log frame na right space log frame ng NEDA. Doon nyo na i-document yung steps 1 to 7. Tapos sa step 9, submitin nyo sa mga head ninyo for... isasubmit nyo muna pag yung right space log frame, papakita nyo muna uli sa mga claim holders and duty bearers and stakeholders, other actors ninyo, para i-validate and confirm nila na talagang lahat ng agreements ninyo were correctly documented there. So step 9, submitin nyo sa agency head at saka sa DBM. Ang step 10, from the part of DBM, DBM should then review all of the log frames from all the agencies and decide, this is where the prioritization comes in. Which are the priority human rights challenges? Is it poverty? Is it hunger? What is it? Is it based on the log frame? No, that's when the DBM will then prioritize and then decide how to allocate the money. And then, step 11 is already developing the M&E, and 12 is the M&E itself, the monitoring and evaluation. So now we will move to Karen, HRBA. Now we move from spending to deficit spending and financing. Malito. Can we have like a cigarette break before Karen starts? Para ko-convert mo lang ito. Ay, ito akin eh.
Yung mga documents na buhay. Parang so happy. Yes, sir. Let's talk about that.
Thank you.
Tapos tsaka Thank you.
Hello, Jonah. Masarap ba kain mo yan? Sagot ka.
Ayan. Yes, Chief.
Okay. Yung sa directorate, 13 to 16 ba yun? November. Yung November. Okay, so there were several agreements that we arrived at, no? About 8 agreements or so. So, Commenting, Convert, and I were able to attend. Tapos, I think on leave, may sakit yung the other two commissioners. So, is it alright? Pwede bang i-ganun na natin, iruta na natin? Tapos, you get Commenting, kasi kinausap ko na siya riyan eh. Nakuha mo ba yung kanyang kwan? Scan ba ninyo yung signature niya? For Leonard Co?
Yes. Yes, Chair, for Leonard Co. But for today, kung it will be dated today, eh, naka-leave siya.
So, si Commenting. Hindi, yeah, pero yung directorate takwan para masignan. O, sa Monday. Sa Monday, pwede pa. Jake?
The other four, yung four commissioners, ay three commissioners po, chair na lang.
Oh, kaming tatlo yun eh. Si Bert, Manin, at saka ako. Kami yung we were able to attend. So, ang pwedeng gawin, you know, yung suggestion mo, sinabi ko na rin, na pwede nilang basahin and then they give their comments. In the same way, we had Leonard Co. They were part of the process except that during the day of the signing, wala lang sila, di ba? So they make a separate paper, attach na lang natin sa internal papers natin, a document natin. So they can do the same thing for the directorate because they were not around. But as far as the three of us are concerned, we were there when it was, you know, agreed upon
kahapon.
Pero binigyan mo po sila ng, meron na silang advance
copy. Ah, meron na sila.
Advance copy, tapos supposedly dapat iti-take up siya yesterday. Tapos nabasa namin yung email mo, Chair. So nagbigay na naman kami today.
Sige. Basta follow up lang, ma'am. And then, again, so yun ha. Basta i-follow up natin. Then let's set a deadline for the signing. Para ma-sign na nakaagad. Kasi DBM needs the OP item. And those are 6 agreements that we really have to unite on. Tapos kailangan malaman din ang lahat ng regions. Again, yung resolution on the Bundok Peninsula installation, the Region 4 investigation report, please give it to me already, Commanding. It's in Commanding's office. Kunin na natin so we can give this to the peasants, to the farmers, katarungan. They've been asking for it months ago. And I think it's time, they need it badly. They need it badly in their negotiations with DAR. And I think we should give it to them. This is katarungan, Dami Karansa. Okay? Nakapon, nung nag-get back meeting tayo, di ba? Hiningi ko yan sa inyo, si Rose. So, can I have a copy? Tapos, magbigay tayo ng kopya kay Dami Karansa. Write him a letter. Then another thing, sige, nag-e-embank meeting na tayo ha. Yung ating Leonard ko, has it been properly distributed? Can I have a written report listing of kung kanino na ibigay ito? Dr. Raquel Fortune read it. And again, sa rights sa House of Representatives, nakita ko siya. She was very happy and satisfied with our conclusion. Saka yung resolution natin. Start na tayo. Sige, okay na yon. So can I have the resolution today? Yung kwan sa Bundok Peninsula? Sige, basta I have to have it today. Sige, let's start na.
Okay. Shall we continue? Itong section na to, sorry to bother your lunch, pero para matapos na before one. This section now tackles the issue of deficit spending. So kanina, si Cookie discussed taxation and spending. So after you have done your taxation correctly, following human rights principles, and then you go into spending. It turns out that your tax revenues are not adequate to meet your required spending. So what happens? The government goes into borrowing or deficit spending. Basically, this section argues that the current policy for a deficit spending is inadequate from a human rights. So we will tackle 3 questions. What are the limits to current policy on deficit spending? How can HRBA principles guide deficit spending and financing? And then by way of a summary, we answer what are the elements of the HRBA to spending and financing. Let's look at fiscal policy, past and present. I mean, from a human rights perspective, we can say that fiscal policy has been central to the failure to realize minimum essential levels of economic and social rights. Ito yung na-describe natin kanina. If we look at the 2003 to 2008 period, this is the time when government started to reduce its spending significantly, and the impact has been here you get significant impact in terms of total real per capita spending, real spending on economic and social services and so on. Halimbawa, here Ben Diokno analyzes real per capita spending. Total spending from 2002 to 2005 went down from 6,700 pesos per capita to 5,800 in real terms. In terms of spending on economic and social services, you have also a decline from 11.2% in 1999 to 2000 to an average of 9.2% of GDP from 2001 to 2005. 2001 to 2005, this is the period of fiscal consolidation. And the third row shows that real per pupil spending, education, also went down from 1999 to from the start of the decade to 2001-2006, from 5,800 to around 5,300. And finally, you also see a fall in real per capita health spending over the same period. So this is the impact of fiscal consolidation in the period 2003 to 2008. And as we said, government went into fiscal consolidation because it was concerned about the fiscal deficit and public borrowing. The present policy, fiscal policy, unfortunately, is not very different. In the 2011 to 2016 Philippine Development Plan, if you look at the macroeconomic section, it's entirely focused on fiscal policy. It's as if the government has a single-minded objective, which is to reduce the deficit. It defines fiscal policy as one of achieving fiscal consolidation. That's just another term for a reduction in the fiscal deficit, while at the same time substantially increasing the country's investments in infrastructure, health, and education. So mukhang okay naman, no? They're trying to balance fiscal consolidation with some increases in infrastructure, social, and health spending. How do they do this? Ito yung targets ng PDP 2011 to 2016. The important column is the last column, yung change. According to the PDP, what's going to happen is that they will increase revenues by plus 2.4% of GDP. And because of that, they will increase yung primary expenditures, that is the non-interest expenditures, by 1.8%. of GDP. That way, the increase in revenue is not, hindi lahat nilagay sa increase in expenditures. Some of it is used to reduce the deficit, and that's why you have a reduction in the, say, in the primary balance from minus 0.2 to 0.4. So the government is projecting the total deficit of the national government to go down from 3.7% of GDP to 2.0%. Okay, the target for the PDP is 2.0% of GDP deficit. Ito kasi yung prescription ng IMF, that you should not exceed 2% of GDP. Let's look at year one of PDP 2011 to 2016. What happened in the first year of this plan? There was an increase, again, look at the third column. There was an increase in revenues of equivalent to 0.6% of GDP. And as I said earlier, there was a decrease in interest payments of minus 0.4. So that gives you an additional spending room of around 1% of GDP. Right? But what did the government do? They reduced primary expenditures by minus 1.5%. Of course, the effect is they have a very good primary balance, not very good, but they have a positive primary balance, and the government was able to reduce its total balance or total deficit to minus 2%. This is 2011. In other words, in the first year of the plan, they hit their target. This is a draconian measure, no? And you do your expenditure compression na dapat spread out in 5 years, in 1 year. That's what they actually did, no? So now they have hit their 2016 target. Of course, we know the consequences. The consequences are not different from what we have shown earlier. You would expect, you know, cuts in infrastructure investment, health spending, social spending, and so on. There's no reason to believe that the consequences of this kind of policy is different from the previous period of fiscal consolidation. Okay, given that, what I do in this section is to try to apply HRBA principles to developing a framework for deficit spending. And I think there are three principles that are very relevant: the primacy of human rights, the obligation to use maximum available resources, and the principle of non-retrogression. First, let's look at primacy of human rights. One possible interpretation in the fiscal area is that, again, if you want an HRBA, a human rights-based approach, you must look at the end goals. You focus on the end goal. Fiscal actions must be judged on their impact on human rights. Sometimes a given fiscal measure has a direct impact on human rights. Halimbawa, Cookie was describing earlier yung taxation. Your tax policies can have a direct impact on human rights. But some fiscal measures, their impact on human rights is intermediated by their impact on the economy. So you have a fiscal measure that has an impact on the economy, which then has an impact on human rights. This is the case with deficit spending and public borrowing. In a sense, fiscal deficit spending has an impact on the economy, and which in turn has an impact on human rights. But the primacy of human rights argues that you should be concerned about the ultimate impact, the ultimate impact on human rights. I say this is very relevant because in the present framework, government is concerned about indicators like the deficit, the public debt stock. They don't go to the next box, which is the impact of that on human rights. If we interpret it this way, the goals of fiscal policy should be, in the short term, the satisfaction of minimum essential levels of rights. These are your core obligations. I put it as short term because I think the way it is stated, regardless of the level of economic, these are actually non-negotiable. Core obligations should be satisfied immediately. That is why I think the goal of fiscal policy in the short term should be to satisfy this core obligation. In the long term, the goal is the full realization of economic and social rights. These goals, of course, are very different from the standard euro fiscal policy. The other principle, the second principle, is maximum available resources. The obligation to mobilize and devote maximum available resources to progressively realize human rights. I think this is where the tension between human rights and the standard view of fiscal policy is very evident. Ano ba yung available resources? DBM will tell you that the available resources are government revenues. Here we argue that the available resources are the real resources in the economy, as Kuti explained earlier, and not just the government budget. This calls into question yung there are really no budget constraints. Even the concept of fiscal space is very limited. Fiscal space as if government has a limited set of resources that it can employ to the, for the fulfillment of human rights. In reality, government can and does spend what it wants. I'll give you an example. Yung CCT, conditional cash transfer, how much is that? 20-40 billion yata ang budget. That was implemented at a time when government revenues were down and government was trying to reduce its deficit. But because it was fashionable to go into CCT, the government said they wanted to go into CCT. And in reality, there are no operational limits to what government can spend. It depends on, sabi nga ni, I think the former budget secretary Enriquez was saying, pag sinabi ng boss mo na gusto ko yung project na ginto, ikaw yung budget secretary, hanapan mo ng pera. You cannot say that there is a budget deficit. Hanapan mo ng pera at mahahanapan mo yan ng pera. Okay. So of course, the question, ano ngayon? What are the limits? What then is the limit to government spending? Sasabihin naman sa, di government can spend as much as it wants? No, of course not. We would argue that the real resource constraint for the government is not the budget deficit or its revenues, but it is the productive capacity of the economy. When you want to apply the principle of MAR, maximum available resources, you have to mobilize all the available resources in the economy. And this is equivalent to a policy goal of full employment. You want to employ all the resources of the economy in order to fulfill your rights obligation. That is why in this interpretation, MAR would be equivalent to a policy of full employment. Maximum available resources is equivalent to a policy of full employment. The implication is that the real constraint to government spending is the productive capacity of the economy. The so-called budget deficits are self-imposed constraints. Those are financial constraints. And if you're talking about real resources, then it is the economy that matters. It is the entire economy that matters. Okay, so here, the real resource constraint to the realization of rights is full employment. The real resource constraint to the realization of rights is full employment. In other words, government has the power and the policy tools to mobilize resources outside of its budget constraint. I mean, it can print money, for example, it can issue money to buy goods and services. It has the central bank, it can use the powers of the central bank to mobilize resources. The reason that it is a resource constraint is that you cannot produce more than what the economy can produce. Or you cannot demand more than what the economy. Suppose government spending, because of government spending, you exceed what the economy can produce. What happens is you have inflation. So you have a high government demand that exceeds the ability of the economy to produce. Then you have inflation. Tataas ang presyo. And that is when inflation becomes a constraint to government spending. In this sense also, you can look at it as low productive capacity is a constraint to the realization of rights. So if you have low productive capacity, what you do is, okay. Here we argue that deficit spending is a powerful policy tool to mobilize resources in the economy. So the government can mobilize resources outside of its revenue by engaging in deficit spending. Deficit spending can serve two purposes. On the supply side of the economy, you can invest in the economy's domestic productive capacity. So kung mababa yung productive capacity ng economy, the government can invest. Invest in infrastructure, invest in agriculture, industry, industrial activities, and so on. But that's on the supply side. You invest in, you improve the economy's productive capacity. And the others, on the demand side, deficit spending can ensure that total demand can buy all goods and services that the economy can produce. I will discuss first the supply side and then later the yung demand side. No? Kasi sa ngayon malaki yung bias against deficit spending because deficit spending leads to public borrowing and a high public debt stock. No? And yung traditional discourse has placed a lot of emphasis on the risks of borrowing, public borrowing, and a high public debt stock. What is often forgotten is that borrowing on the part of government creates liabilities. We're very familiar with that. But also assets. When you borrow, when the government borrows, that means that it spends those borrowing in the creation of certain assets. So the question from a human rights perspective is how much of borrowing create assets that support rights? Or to what extent do assets raise productivity and income? In other words, ano yung quality ng assets that were financed by government borrowing? One specific proposal in this respect is to make the decision making in the NEDA ICC more transparent. Kasi dito dumadaan yung malalaking borrowings, foreign borrowings of government. The projects that are financed by a lot of foreign borrowing go through the NEDA ICC process. So if you want to ensure the quality of those assets, it is important that that process is guided by what Cookie described earlier as Panther principle, participatory, and so on. Hindi ko alam yun. But again, the main point here is that when you have borrowings, you also have assets. It is balanced by assets. The other point is that the availability of resources can be enhanced by investing in resource generating assets. What do we mean by this? Maximum available resources. The maximum available resources is not something that is given from outside. It is not an exogenous variable. It is something that you can influence, or policy can influence. And how do you influence your maximum available resources? By investing in resource generating resources. When government invests, say, in infrastructure or in social services, economic services, that raises the productive capacity of the economy. That will result into economic growth in the future. And that future economic growth will raise government revenue, to which expands your available resources. So it matters where you spend your available resources. If you invest your available resources in resource-generating assets, then that makes it more sustainable. But the other point is, there is an issue between short-term and long-term. Short-term, the government is usually concerned with the deficit. It is a very short-term view. But you may go into deficit now. In the short term, this argument says that you can go into deficit in the short term so that in the long run, you will have more revenues. So there is an issue between short-term and long-term. Another specific proposal in this light is that when you estimate or you compute the primary surplus or the deficit, you should actually not include capital outlay. When the government goes into fiscal, so-called fiscal consolidation, it cannot reduce PS, personal services, because fixed na yan. What does it do? It reduces MOE and capital outlays. Of course, in the long run, that is a very negative impact on growth, on economic growth as well. So what? It's always capital outlays that is sacrificed, no, in order to meet the fiscal targets. So the proposal is, you should, actually this is not an original proposal, it's something that's available in the literature, but the proposal is that capital outlays should be taken out. Don't include capital outlays when you are estimating the primary surplus or deficit. Accountants should be familiar with this. So business, if you're familiar with net income statement of businesses, profit and loss of business, hindi naman nila sinasama yung capital investments. Diba? Capital investments are not included in the net, in the income statement of businesses. The reason is that yung depreciation mo lang ang sinasama mo as an expense. This is actually the practice in the private sector. Don't include your capital outlay. The implication is that if we do it that way, then you have more room for productive expenditures in the budget. Now let's go into the issue of sustainable public debt. Ang lagi kasing sinasabi is that we should avoid a large public debt. Maraming arguments dyan. Politicians would tell you that the government is like any household that should live within its means. Well, that is not true, because the government is a different entity. A government can issue its own currency, and therefore it cannot go bankrupt with respect to domestic debt. Kahit gaano pa kalaki yung utang mo, as long as it's in the domestic currency, pesos. Kahit gaano pa kalaki yung utang mo sa pesos, the government will always be able to repay that because it issues that currency. Of course, there's a situation when it cannot repay, when the state is about to fail, and you have a failed state, siguro you cannot repay your debt. But that is not the scenario that we are in. There is also the myth of mortgaging future generations. Parang this is also an argument that's made by even by NGOs and CSOs, no? That a high public debt mortgages future generations. This is simply not true because future generations do not send payments back to past generations. Interest payments stay within the economy. Of course, there is a redistribution issue. Ang problema sa interest payments and the debt, it's only the wealthy, it's usually the rich and the wealthy and the financial institutions who hold government debt. So sa kanila nababayad yung, napupunta yung interest payments. So there is a redistribution issue in the sense that it's a regressive form of spending. It's a redistribution from the general taxpayers to financial and wealthy individuals. Of course, the answer to that is you have to make sure that the borrowing in the first place was spent on productive and progressive types of expenditure. Sa ganon, it's balanced. The third argument is that interest payments displace social and economic services. Again, this is a common argument that's made by many, even our friends. And it is argued that kung mataas yung interest payments mo, wala ka nang gagastusin for social and economic services. But that is true only if the government adheres to a self-imposed budget constraint. The only reason that you are not spending enough on social services, for example, is not because of interest payment. It's because the government does not want to expand its budget. Okay. Let me now go into, this one is a little more technical. There is a common tool in used by economists. They call it debt sustainability analysis. Basically, it's a tool to project whether your public debt is too high or not. So let's say the public debt now is around 50% of GDP. So they go into a debt sustainability analysis and answer the question, Is this debt too high? Let me just summarize in that. Anyway, this kind of framework tells you that the change in public debt is due to a number of factors. It's not just the deficit is one, the primary balance, the deficit or surplus, is just one of the many factors affecting the public debt stock. The interest rate and the public debt, economic growth, inflation rate, all these variables explain changes in the public debt. Of course, ang palaging focus ng government is the deficit. But in truth and in fact, there are many other factors that can affect the public debt. Of course, the problem with this, in the paper we try to show that this kind of analysis has no basis in theory and in practice. There is no such thing as a sustainable debt. And it is very difficult to project what will happen to the public debt in the future. The basic reason for that is, as we saw earlier, there are so many factors affecting the public debt that it is impossible to make projections on what's going to happen in the future. The first critique of this kind of analysis is that it does not say anything about the optimality of that ratio. In other words, you cannot say whether a 70% of GDP debt is too high or 50% is too high, 90% is too high. In the literature, there is no such thing as an optimal debt ratio. The more important problem is that it's very difficult to project all these variables over the long term. Ang mga government borrowings kasi, some of government bonds are like, ang maturity nila 20 years. You have a 20-year treasury bond. That means if you want to do this analysis, you have to make projections over the next 20 years. But that is not the problem. Pagdating ng 20 years, yung government, i-roll over niya yung debt. It will not pay that debt. It will borrow again to roll over the 20-year debt. So you have what you call quasi-permanent debt. Debt that is not really repaid over time. And this is not a problem because this is a problem for an ordinary business and an ordinary household. Why? Because an ordinary household has a limited lifespan. But a government has an unlimited lifespan. So this is the problem with... The other serious problem is that some components of sustainability affect each other. If you reduce your deficit in order to reduce your borrowings, that will also affect your GDP growth. But because you have a lower GDP growth, you now have a higher public debt to GDP ratio. So in the end, you want to reduce your deficit, but in the end, you may end up raising your deficit, raising your public debt. But here, I will use debt sustainability analysis to look at the past, the evolution of the Philippine debt. Okay, this looks technical, pero hindi. The bars tell you the change in the debt. Halimbawa, ano? The public debt, for instance, in 2000 and in 2000. But then the different colors tell you what is causing the change in the public debt. What is causing the rise or the fall in the public debt? And the point that kanina, di ba, we said there are a lot of factors. One is the primary deficit, which is the blue. Ito yan, blue. This is the primary deficit. The interest rate, the exchange rate is the green one. Those are the factors, some of the major factors affecting the public debt. Now, this graph tells you how the public debt evolved from 2004 to 2010. The reason I bring this up is that in 2003 and 2004, the government went into fiscal consolidation in order to reduce the high public debt. But if you notice from 2000, if you notice from 2001 to 2003, it's not the primary deficit that is causing the rise in the public debt. It was exchange rate depreciation and a certain residual. So from 2000 to 2003, it is true that the public debt was growing, but it was not due to the government. It was not due to government spending. It was due to exchange rate depreciation. Nevertheless, in 2004 up to 2008, the government went into expenditure reduction, and you have a fall in the public debt. But this graph also tells you that even without expenditure reduction, in 2004 to 2008, bumababa pa rin dapat yung public debt. In other words, the fiscal consolidation during that period was not necessary to bring down the public debt. In other words, the problem would have resolved itself. Now the thing is that yung fiscal consolidation was a very costly policy measure, as we showed earlier. Okay. Another human rights principle that I want to apply is the principle of non-retrogression. The non-retrogression principle imposes an obligation to ensure that the enjoyment of rights does not retrogress, especially during periods of crisis. Okay? How does it apply to deficit to fiscal policy? The standard view is that there is a lot of emphasis on coping with the impact of crisis using targeted social safety nets. Ito yung iyong conditional cash transfer. In a sense, from an HR perspective, that's a positive development. You're trying to cope with the impact of crisis. But there are important issues here. One is the issue of targeting versus universalism. Yung targeting ng government is often justified because of resource constraints. You have very limited budget, you have so many poor people, so how do you ensure that your resources are used efficiently? You go into targeting. On the other hand, I think in human rights you can argue for your more universalistic approach, applying the principles of non-discrimination, universal application of rights, and so on. The other issue, I believe, with regards to social safety nets is the issue of coping versus preventing. The social safety nets compensate victims of a crisis after the crisis has happened. But there are also preventive measures, and these are things that the current policy usually avoids. They don't want to go into preventive measures because, according to this argument, they distort the economy or they distort markets. I would argue that deficit spending is critical to preventing or reducing fluctuations in economic activity. And here, there are three reasons for this. Capitalist economies like the Philippines are inherently unstable. Kahit anong gawin mo, we are inherently unstable. Why? The reason is investments. Investments is based on expectations of future profit, and expectations are highly unstable. today, businessmen may be very optimistic about the future. Suddenly, tomorrow, we wake up and those expectations are gone. And you have an entirely different view of the economy. The second point is that instability in this era is now exacerbated by globalization and capital flows. Whether we like it or not, we are affected by what happens outside. You are affected by crisis in the US, we are affected by crisis in Europe, and so on. And the third argument is that government and no one else has the ability to stabilize the economy. So it is, in this sense, it is a mandate on the government to stabilize the economy. And here we argue that deficit spending is a key tool to stabilize the economy. There are three ways of, for three reasons. First is that deficit spending, when the government spends, it raises employment and private sector income. Okay. This is quite easy to understand. Government buys services, goods and services. The private sector produces those goods. It adds to the business of employment and profits of the private sector. The other point is that deficit in the public sector means a surplus in the private sector. Okay? So when the government has a deficit, the other side of that is a surplus in the private sector. And why does that happen? Because government, when I'm government, I spend on something. In other words, the private sector receives what I spend. So yung deficit ko is now a surplus to the private sector. And this is very important during times of crisis. Dahil bumabagsak yung economy, it is very important that government go into deficit spending in order to lessen the impact of recession in the private sector. The third one is about here. Government borrowing provides safe, risk-free investment opportunities to the financial sector. This is more to do with your banking system. When the economy is in crisis, ibabagsak ang business, banks are not going to lend to just anyone. They're going to reduce their lending because they do not know who is about to go bankrupt. The entire economy is in a bad system, no one's going to lend. Mahirap umutang sa banko kahit magandang creditor ka. Why? Because banks do not know whether your business is going to go bankrupt too. The problem is you have a banking system now, saan nila i-invest yung pera nila? During the recession, the only risk-free investment is government borrowing. That is why deficit spending, which is equivalent to government borrowing, becomes very important during periods of crisis. I think you can see this in the US now. This is the problem of European countries. They cannot just go into deficit because may mga bawal. Secondly, they do not issue their own currency. European countries cannot issue their own currency. Therefore, they cannot borrow as much as they want. Because that's the trade-off to having a monetary union. That is why it is far more difficult to resolve the European crisis now than the US crisis in 2008. Anong ginawa ng US government? They saved their banks. They rescued their banks. The Federal Reserve rescued the banks. That is something that the European governments cannot do because they have given up their right to issue their own currency. Ano na lang yan ngayon, di ba? Yung the euro. So, yeah. Yeah, that the European Central Bank now has to do that function of the national central bank. But that took a lot of negotiations before we could actually act that way. And I think that at that point in 2008, it was necessary to rescue the bank. Otherwise, you would have had a much deeper crisis in the U.S. The rest, they're only calling it now Great Recession because yung 1930s depression was still worse, but it's not very far. In other words, if you did not rescue the banks then, you would have a bigger problem. So I think, in that sense, it was imperative. There was no other way but to rescue the banks. Otherwise, the financial sector would stop functioning. Now, is it the problem is that did not cost anything. It just needed a few strokes in the computer of the Federal Reserve to rescue those banks. Inadjust lang naman yung mga ledgers nila sa Federal Reserve. The problem is that the current U.S. government does not want to go into larger stimulus spending. Kaya job creation is very slow in the U.S. because the government does not want to go into stimulus spending. Kasi yung mga Republicans, they don't want a big deficit. So they're blocking every move of the government. Ayan.
That will adversely affect the CHR, and also other government agencies. This is a reform under the finance. This is the one treasury account, wherein all there's just one treasury account for the government. So it's entire all the government agencies, including corporations, are covered. So all our transactions are in the one treasury account. At this point in time, the CFAC members, the CFAC agencies, are just encouraged to be part of this one treasury account. But eventually, if this whole program of reform by the Department of Budget, this is a tripartite program of reform under the finance, with COA, DBM, and finance sector, the Department of Finance, with, of course, the attached agencies, the FST, and all. So this is actually a reform in the finance, where they want to see, at one point, all the monies of the government agency. So it's really a way of the government to know where all the monies are and where they are spent. Ano yun? The extreme side of this is extreme implementation of this is the one payroll system. Those one account, one treasury account is the one treasury account has components in, and the component that is very that will support that will be the first your IT, the whole IT system. So this is actually a reform in the finance sector that's also patterned after other government agencies, other countries. And when they explained this to us, yung tiga COA, isang commission, isang director ng COA, was saying na there are many models of the one treasury account. One from the very extreme of Spain is, and the liberal of Australia. So, kaya yung mga government leaders natin have been, for the past years na ito eh, it was during the time of GMA, so past several years na, and this has a very big infrastructure, IT infrastructure. So, kasi we were questioning, although the motives, the objectives are noble in the sense that they want, that the government wants to find out where the money is in the government. For instance, yung mga borrowing and also the, lahat ng mga sa personnel, yung kung saan talaga. Kasi they knew, and we all know naman, na ang government agencies are not spending wisely, or we are understanding government contracts, the government contracts, diba? Hindi na i-implement ang mga projects, mga ganun. But they want to find out, and through the one treasury system, alam nila kung nasaan ang pera. Bawat ahensya ng gobyerno, alam nila kung magkano. Alam nila kung, and then they want even to the point na yung one personnel system, ang isang personnel na lang, hindi na magkakaroon ng, hindi na di-distribute sa mga agencies ang swelduhan through ATM din direction na from BDM. So I just want to find out, know that if you know of this development, it is being discussed in and we are required now to just have one account. One bank account. Kasi before that, where government agencies have also may mga trust fund accounts, may iba-iba accounts. So there's only one account na lang, and that we should report that to the department, up to the I think all the money.
Inform them of not only our trust account, but also those that are being extended to us by foreign partners. Because naturally, the trust accounts are those coming from funding agencies. So since they've requested us to inform them of all the bank accounts, they would know how much would be coming from funding organizations.
Independent.
Yeah.
ano yun. And then down the road, makikita nila na marami kayong funds, and they're going to cut your back. And then they're going to cut back.
I think the greater implication there is at the issue is really control of public finance versus autonomy of certain institutions that would ordinarily have the autonomy to use its own funds. No? It's really the control. The information is not should not be a problem. Eh? They can ask for reports, etc. But it's really the control of public finance, at least in application.
Government spending, diba? Kasi if the DBM would see in your account or in the treasury in the one treasury system that you have not been spending, naturally its inclination will be to cut your budget or not to release the appropriation allotted for you, which means that in terms of the way that you spend, that would be very much limited in terms of that would be very limited, diba? So hindi ko alam kung it's an answer of the government to deficit to our deficit right now, but as presented in the study, government deficit might, di ba? It also is a way of increasing the what you call that government spending. A government deficit would mean also a government deficit spending would mean also na marami sa public, di ba? Ano ayon? There was this statement. Hindi, yung government, tatlong reasons that were cited.
Okay.
The first reason that was cited.
Employment and income. Yes, correct. That's what I was about to say. The transparency is parang in a context where the DBM is very tight fiscal policy, tapos that kind of reform, alam mo na yung gagawin nila, di ba? They're going to use it to reduce your budget. Because right now they don't have information on your other sources of funding.
This maybe lang naman, I don't know if it can be done, that there could be a space for discussion between duty bearer relations as we see it in public finance. Like in this case, it's the oversight functions of DBM intention with
the oversight functions of human rights institutions. Parang ganon. Just to be able to put in that debate about why there is good in a one treasury system in terms of perhaps transparency and accountability, but that is only one dimension of human rights-based approach to public finance, because you have oversight institutions in charge of human rights as well. So parang ganun lang, just to be able to probably apply it to our discussion.
Yeah. Actually, marami pang issues. This is just a first attempt to apply HRBA to public finance. And I'm sure there are many other issues in public finance that we have not touched, and where the HRBA principles can be very relevant. Just to finish the paper, the last part of the paper points to new potential sources of revenues for government. And here we look at yung gross foreign exchange reserves, gross international reserves of the central bank. Ito yung mga hawak ng central bank na dollars or foreign exchange. If you have dollars, you cannot use dollars in the Philippines, right? You have to exchange it with pesos. And eventually, the dollars end up with the central bank. Pinalit mo man sa money exchanger, the money exchanger na i-convert din niya into pesos, and at the end of the day, nasa central bank yung dollar. But it turns out now, because of the very massive inflow of remittances, that the central bank has reserves of something like 85 billion in November 2012. Let's see how big this is. Yung foreign debt ng Philippines is only about 60 billion. I remember several decades ago, namumroblema tayo kung paano natin babayaran ng foreign debt ng Pilipinas. No? Ngayon, pwede mo nang bayaran, meron ka pang $20 billion. Sobra. Okay, because we are, it comes from OFW remittances, we are the third largest in the world, behind China and India. Important point is that this money, GIR, the reserves of the central bank, is not borrowed money. We did not borrow it. This is not borrowed money. Therefore, you can invest it. It is prudent to invest this money into something else. And we argue that forex reserves are investable resources. They represent foregone fiscal and economic returns that could be used to provide economic and social rights. One way of doing this is, I don't know if you've heard of a sovereign wealth fund, the central bank can set up as another institution. A sovereign wealth fund is simply, pwede mong isipin na parang it's a separate division within the central bank that manages your reserve. But countries formally set up a sovereign wealth fund to manage the reserves like a pension fund. You can invest in investment instruments all over the world, or you can invest your money in domestic development projects. Or you can invest that money in a foreign company and then convince that company to invest in the Philippines. So there are many ways of using these resources, and this adds to your maximum available resources. That's why we discuss it here. We do some estimates of potential revenues and economic gain. Of course, the first step is, magkano ba ang pwedeng i-invest doon? You cannot invest everything, because there are normal trading requirements. The central bank requires, for instance, 3 months of imports. Dapat palagi kang may reserves na equivalent to 3 months of imports. Para kung may mangyari man sa labas, you have money to sustain you over 3 months. So, excess reserves in this sense, we compute as something like 57 to 64 billion. In other words, out of the 85 billion, siguro ang pwede mo lang invest mga 50 to 60 billion. If you set up a sovereign wealth fund with that money, you would be at the top 20 in the world. Ganun kalaki yung pera natin. We would be alongside para tayong mga oil exporters, mga OPEC countries. OPEC countries have huge SWMs. Or we're like China, South Korea, Australia, and Singapore. Mayaman tayo. Ayan, so you have here a paradox of, you know, poverty amidst plenty. We have many poor people, but we have plenty of resources. The question is, how do you use these resources? Well, one estimate that we do is if you invest these resources in stocks, equity, bonds all over the world, that will give you extra fiscal revenues of around 1% of GDP annually. Annually, 1% of GDP. So that covers your MDG financing gap. Yan, di ba? The other way of looking at it is, if you invested 57 to 64 billion in domestic projects, halimbawa mga infrastructure projects natin, di ba? According to NEDA ICC, para pumasa yung isang public project, it should show an economic return of something like 15% para ma-justify mo sa NEDA yung isang infrastructure project. In other words, foregone economic returns of this amount of money is equivalent to 3% of GDP annually. That's a big amount, considering that we are growing only at 5%. 5% growth. So the use of this foreign exchange reserve is one way to expand your available resources, maximum available resources. And this is something that has not been explored, no? By the central bank. So far, ang ginawa ng central bank, pinautang niya sa IMF yung pera. Bragging rights. We save Europe. We help save Europe. Yeah, but here we're saying that this can add to your maximum available resources, because those reserves are investable resources. They are real resources that you can invest. Now, fiscal revenues, you can add 1% of GDP to fiscal revenues simply by investing the excess reserves in equities, which will earn. We haven't done that. We are only investing in U.S. treasuries. This is fairly recent. Siguro mga, you had a current account surplus only in 2003. Before kasi, in palaging deficit yung current account natin, that's why you cannot invest your reserves because you need it. You had to be, for precautionary purposes, you had to have a large amount of reserve. Pero ngayon, surplus na palagi yung ating current account, exports and imports. Exports exceed imports every year. Now you can think about investing your excess reserve. This one is coming from OFW. Sabi, yung reserves natin is now 85 billion, di ba? The foreign debt, the foreign debt is only about 65 billion. Okay? You can, yes. Yes. Yes, actually you can use this to finance your deficit. Instead of investing it, you can also use it to finance your deficit. So the government can borrow from the central bank. Actually, the central bank, because ang laki na ng reserves ng central bank, they don't know what to do with it. They've been telling government, don't borrow from abroad. Borrow from us. That's what they've been saying. Oh, don't issue foreign bonds anymore. Borrow from us. That's what he has been telling. But I don't know what happened to that. That was a good proposal. Under the charter kasi ng charter ng central bank, they cannot lend to the government.
There's a law. Need to amend the law.
Yes, there's a need to amend the law to do that. No?
Possibility, Clarence, to study this particular one treasury system in relation to government deficit spending and the finding that you made that when there is deficit spending, it increases the total demand in the economy. And when there's fiscal surplus, it diminishes, it decreases, diba, the total demand. So, kung magkakaroon ka ng one treasury system at magkakaroon ng control doon sa funding para sa mga other government agencies, including constitutional commissions, baka magiging fiscal surplus naman na siya, eventually. And would the people from the DBM, the Department of Finance, know about this? I mean, ang akin ng point is perhaps it would be good when we share it with them on January that this one be given emphasis also. And I don't know whether there is really a relation between adopting a one treasury system from that of answering the deficit in government spending.
Tingnan natin. Hindi rin kami familiar sa details eh. So, okay. You know how important the okay, the last point that I want to make is, I think it's been, we have hinted on this earlier. Different rights call for different financing forms and institutional instruction. Ang example ko dito is the right to the highest standard of health. There are several ways of financing health services. One is through direct provision. Halimbawa, yung DOH budget. DOH budget, in a way, is one form of financing yung right to health. But the other important financing is PhilHealth. And this is the idea of a universal health insurance coverage. International experience shows that the best way to control health costs, kasi yon yung magiging problema din natin, no? In the future. The best way to control health costs is through a universal health, a single payer universal health insurance, PhilHealth. Parang meron kang PhilHealth that will provide insurance to all, to everybody. The point is that if you are interested in specific rights, you may have to look at the budget, you may have to go outside of the budget, and you have to look at other parts of the public sector that are involved in financing this right. The other example is the right to adequate food. The usual response is food distribution during crisis. But another preventive measure is to have buffer stocks to prevent a food crisis. Ang example dito yung NFA. Again, the NFA is critical to implementing your right to adequate food. Medyo hindi maganda kasi yung usual na pagtingin sa NFA. The NFA is usually seen as a cost center dahil deficit yan eh. So lahat ng mga economists, they suggest abolish NFA. But you can look at it from a rights perspective. And I would argue that NFA is necessary to prevent a food crisis. Ang example dyan is the 2008 World Rice Crisis. Kaya nagkaroon, in a sense, what exacerbated the World Rice Crisis was NFA going to the world market to buy 2.5 million tons of rice. That is why I'm saying that the role of the NFA is very crucial in addressing food crisis, especially in an era of climate change. Malakas yung pressures on food production systems. You expect more frequent periods of food shortages, more volatile world prices sa food. And here, from this perspective, it is very important that you have a domestic agency that will try to address this issue. One is just a summary, so I won't go into SF. Doctors will. Yes, that's exactly the point. A universal health insurance, malakas ang bargaining power. So you will have, that's the only way you can control the prices of doctors' services, hospital charges. You have so many procedures, bagong procedures that are very costly with doubtful medical, what do you call that? With doubtful medical benefits. Ang daming procedures that are now very expensive. Yun yung nagpapataas ng health costs. And that is why even for the U.S., if you compare the U.S. with the other European countries, yung other countries, except the U.S., meron silang universal health care. Single payer. It's one that is managed by the government. Kaya yung health expenditures doon, mas mababa. The cost of health services are far lower than in the U.S., where it's a mixture of private sector and government health insurance. Yun din ang, I'm sure you notice here, no? After we have the generics medicine law, okay na tayo sa drugs and medicine, di ba? Medyo mababa na yung pressure. But you will notice that pag nakita mo yung hospital bill mo, professional fees, no? Yan naman ang pamatay. The hospitalization, hospital charges and so on. Hindi na yung gamot ang mahal ngayon. But I think the only response to that is a universal health system.
And then, what are the Philippine Accountability Institutions? So, ito yung human rights demands of public accountability. Public accountability is the last part of the cycle of public finance kasi. So, ito yung mga demands ng human rights, and I think it's fairly easy to understand. When you want to demand accountability from any government agency, then you will approach the different Philippine public accountability institutions, and one of them is, of course, the CHR. So you're not only a human rights institution, you're actually a public accountability institution as well. And what the paper does is simply to define or describe the different public accountability institutions. And that is our HRBA to public finance. We took 3 hours of your time. We hope you learned something from it. Okay, any questions?
Initially, this presentation was supposed to be with the 4 agencies of government that should know about this particular study, namely the Department of Finance, the Department of Budget and Management, Central Bank, and NEDA. But because of time constraint, we had to postpone it. We had to postpone the presentation for these partners. And we also envision, we are inviting also 4 NGO non-government organizations involved in public finance, in monitoring public finance, and they are, as far as I can recall, the FDC, Freedom from Debt Coalition, PRRM, and Social Watch. So we are inviting them for the January presentation and peer review, what we call it. What we did was to forward to them a copy of the study so that they would have the time to, of course, peruse the material. And when they come to the CHR, upon invitation of the chair, they would be able to respond to some of the concerns and issues that are raised here. So there will be 2 from government that will be doing the peer review and will be presenting to us their comments. That would be PBM and Department of Finance. And then from the NGO side, we invited the PRRM and the FDC to make also their comments. Social Watch, wala. Social Watch, yes, Social Watch. So I'm sorry. So by the second week of January, we're going to have the peer review. So we are again inviting you to that one. And then the second, I think, issue would be also what if there's a possibility for us to present, because you mentioned about the Public Accountability Institution and we have the Constitutional Fiscal Autonomy Group. Perhaps it would also be good for this study to be presented before the CPAC. And then the third issue, I think, would what will the CHR do with this study.
After the peer review, we will consolidate the comments of the reviewers and change whatever needs to be changed, enhance the paper, etc. So perhaps anything else that is, I mean, any other presentation should be done perhaps after the peer review, after that. Because we're going to submit the final paper to CHR, whether you publish it, what you do with it, that's really up to you. Although, sa ako lang, personally, manghihinayang ako, personally, if, you know, we give it to you and then you just keep it in your library, parang sayang naman ang efforts namin ni Clarence lang. So, whatever. Oo, kasi I would suggest nga na kailangan sigurong mas marami ang nakakaalam tungkol dito, tsaka ano, may...
Oh, we're going to send another communication to them saying that there's going to be no presentation of the study, but they're going to be the ones making the presentation. Their comments are recommendations. Okay. Would you want to say the closing remarks? Would you want to say any closing remarks? Because our CSO colleagues are already here for the 1:30 meeting. So,
okay, sure. I think this is very important. I'd like to thank Florence and Cookie for this. This might not have anything to say about me. Hindi niyo sinala. Gusto ko sana sabihin, ako pinag-uusapan niya yung debt. Inaprove ba ni Maite? Inaprove ba ni Maite dito? Pero again, thank you, Cookie. Thank you, Clarence. These are the things that are very necessary for our continuing capacity building. No? Ako, marami naman na ako natututunan eh. I've been doing my own studies and all. And I had chance to look into this again. We look forward, second week of January, and we're going to make a campaign. Kasi this is so important. Good governance yung pinag-uusapan naman natin lagi dito, eh, di ba? Clean governance and so on. So, we'll make sure that internally, we have this studied also by CHR. And then, after the second week, peer review, then we can campaign already in the nationwide yan. Kasi CHR naman eh, I end up with campaigns already ongoing. Okay, so salamat muli. Palakpakan natin. Merry Christmas para sa kanilang dalawa, meron mga. Okay, sige.